All right, so I'm Victor, and I'm a member of the Angular core team. And today I want to tell you about the new change detection system we built for Angular 2. So this is a somewhat technical talk, so if you find something a bit hard to understand, don't worry. I will provide links to the articles and presentations that will cover the same material. And you can, of course, grab me after the talk, and I will answer all your questions. Okay, let's get started. First, let's define what change detection is. And to do that, let's look at this app. It's a very simple app. It has a list of technical talks that you can filter, watch, and rate. Any Angular 2 application will always have a tree of components. Let's say our application will have this tree. Let's look at the components in this tree. We have the filters component that has the speaker input and the filter button. We have the talks component, talks plural, and it's the list you see at the bottom. And we also have a talk, which is an item in that list. All right, in addition to our component tree, our application will have a model. Let's say our model looks like this. So it's a plain old JavaScript object, nothing fancy. Now imagine an event that changes the model. Let's say I've watched the talk, I really liked it, and I like this talk a lot, and I decided to give it 9.9. Awesome. So what we have right now is the updated model. What happens next is, at the end of the VM turn, change detection will walk the component tree, and for every component, it will check the model it depends on, and if that model change, it will update the component. So in our example, this component will be updated. After that, it will update the DOM to match the state of the component tree. In our example, this button will get disabled because you cannot rate the same talk twice. All right? More abstractly, in Angular 2, we separated application state update, or application model update, and view state propagation. So the first part, application state update, is done by your code, your custom code, due to some event. All right? And the second part is done by change detection. So change detection does not update your model anymore. Instead, it just syncs up your model with the component tree, or syncs up your component tree with the model, and your DOM with the component tree. So how is it different from Angular 1? Because Angular 1 right now currently has a very similar mechanism. In Angular 1, these arrows point in both directions. So you can have DOM updating a directive via change detection. And a directive can affect a model, again, via change detection. Moreover, a directive can affect another directive, and a model can affect another model. Or more formally, in Angular 1, our change detection graph has cycles, and in Angular 2, it's a tree. And trees are fantastic. I really like trees because we all know how to reason about them. We understand trees very well, and they also provide nice guarantees. And in my view, it has a profound impact on the dev experience. And I want to give you one example to demonstrate that. So this is Angular 1. Because of the cycles, it's hard to know what gets updated when. In this example, we have two directives, parent and child, and each directive has two bindings. Do you know which one will be updated first, like parent or child? Actually, because of the cycles, the updates can be interleaved. Like, do you know how many times a particular property is checked and updated? It can be zero more or many, zero, one or many, again, because of the cycles. In Angular 2, where we have a tree and we cannot have cycles, we can answer these questions much better. We know exactly what gets checked and how many times. And what is more important, the order of the checks is determined by the template only. So in this example, parent will always be checked before child, regardless of what parent and child are. In addition, the new system is designed in a way that it gets stable after a single pass. So the number of digest iterations is fixed, it's one. You cannot change it. So the whole concept of iterations is no longer present. It's gone. All right, let's see. Hey. Yeah, I think it's awesome. All right, so what we've learned so far? We've learned that in the new system, the change detection graph is a tree. And it makes the system a lot more predictable. We can reason about it better. And finally, the number of digest iterations is 1. And this is what I like most about the new system, is that you can reason about it statically and locally. And what I mean by that is you can look at a template, at a single template, at one file, and you will know how changes propagate without knowing anything else about your application. But of course, the main question for many is, how fast is it? Because we want it to be very fast. To answer this question, let's look at this formula. It defines how long it takes to go through the change detection graph. N here is the number of bindings, total number of bindings in the system. And C is the average time it takes to check a binding. There are two ways to make the system faster. We can decrease C or we can deal with N. Let's start with C. To understand how we made this constant, the average time it takes to check a binding smaller, let's dissect the following binding. It's a very simple binding. A reasonable way to evaluate this binding is to get a getter function for every property read. All right? And then use the getter function to get the value of the property. Of course, we don't have token rating hardcoded in our code base, so we have a generic function that does stuff like that. So first, it takes a getter function for a property read. Then it has an old value of the property stored somewhere. Then it computes a new value, it checks if it's the same, and if it's not, it will invoke the reaction function. This is a very high-level view of the system, so it's not how Angular 1 works exactly, but it sort of gives you an idea. I think this solution is great. I mean, it's easy to understand, it is elegant, but it has one problem. And the problem is that virtual machines do not like this kind of code. They cannot guess the types of the objects here, and as a result, they cannot use the optimization that makes JavaScript fast. The highlighted calls here are polymorphic, and such calls are very expensive. So what do virtual machines like instead? They like the code that looks like this. Here we don't have generic getter functions that we invoke to evaluate our expression. Instead, we just access the value of the field directly. And if the old value is not the same as the new value, we are not going to invoke a generic reaction function anymore. We are going to update the component, again, directly. All the variables here will always have the same shape, like all the objects will always have the same shape, the same type. Virtual machines will be able to deduce those types, and as a result, all the calls here are very fast, they're monomorphic. So what do we do in Angular 2? How do we make it fast? So when compiling a template, when compiling the template of a component, we take all the bindings from the template and we generate a class that looks like this. One class per component. So basically we generate the class that you would write by hand if you wanted to do change detection. And VMs love that. What's important here is that we do it behind the scenes at runtime. So there is nothing you need to do to make it happen, it just happens automatically. And it decreases the average time of checking a binding significantly. Depending on the use case, it makes change detection 3 to 10x faster. And you get it for free, you don't need to change anything about your application. I think it's a very good result. I think the performance of Angular 1 is actually good enough for the majority of apps. And as you can see, Angular 2 is quite a bit faster, 10x faster. But some applications may require even better performance, if you're running on mobile, for example. Let's see how we enable that in Angular 2. To understand that, let's look at this formula again. So what we've learned right now is that the constant is much smaller. But what about N? So can we be smarter about what we check? And the answer is we can. And to see how, let's look at this example. Okay, what we have here is two components. Talk component that contains a list of talk components. So it's basically a list and an item in that list. And what you see on this slide is the templates of the two components. So let's say our change detection system check the model for one of the components. And it happened to be the same instance. So it's the same talk model instance. Can we skip checking the template of that component? No, of course we can't. The object is mutable. So even though the instance is the same, the title, like, it can change. Yes? So we cannot skip it. So Angular has to be conservative and check everything. Because mutable, plain old JavaScript objects, or like JSON-like objects, they don't provide us enough guarantees in regards to how they change. And as a result, we have to go through every single component in the system every single time and check their bindings. All right? But although the JavaScript language itself doesn't give us guarantees, you as a developer, you may know that certain objects in your application, they do not change. Or you know when they change. And now you will be able to give this information to the framework, and it will be smarter about what it checks. For example, let's take a look at immutable objects. So what we have here is exactly the same two components. So the two templates here are identical. The only difference here is that the model, the talk model, is immutable. This gives us the following guarantee. That if the two instances are the same, so if it is the same instance, the title couldn't change. So it's truly the same value. And therefore, if the talk component doesn't have any hidden state, it can change if and only if the instance is replaced. And therefore, if the object is not replaced, if it's the same instance, we can skip that component subtree altogether. So previously, Angular 1, we cannot take advantage of this. And now, in Angular 2, we can. And since only a small fraction of your screen tend to change at once, it can result in huge performance benefits. For example, you won't have to check every single component in your graph, which can be thousands of components. If you use immutable objects, you will check only the path that changed. And you can do it declaratively. When you define a component, you can say that you depend only on immutable objects. We're still playing with the API, trying to find the best one, the one that makes more sense, but the capability is already there. Right, what does it do to our time? How does it affect our time? That's what we had when we used only mutable objects. And n here is the total number of bindings in the system. If you use immutable objects, what you get is this formula. And m here is the number of changed bindings. And m will almost always be much smaller than n. But immutable objects are not the only ones that give us certain guarantees about how they change. Observable objects do it too. They use some sort of push mechanism to tell you that there is a new value that arrived. And here I use the word observable in the broadest sense. So it can be anything that can notify you about changes. It can be Rx. It can be backbone models. It can be knockout models or object that observe. Let's see how it works. So what we have here is exactly the same tree of components, but this time let's imagine that all our models in our application are observable. Observable objects are different from immutables in one very important way. When you use immutable objects, your change always comes from the root. So it has to come from the root. And that's why applications using immutable data tend to have global state that they push through the whole component every single time. That's not the case when you use observables. With observables, a change can come from anywhere. For example, the model of this component, the observable model of this component, can fire an event, basically notify this component about changes. The parent of this component doesn't see any changes. So how do we handle it? What we do in Angular 2, when we encounter the situation, we are going to mark the whole path to the root as to be checked. So when change detection kicks in, it will walk this path and will check all components along the way. And after it does it, the system gets stable again. So observables are great, they are very useful. But you may have one problem with observables. And the problem is called cascading updates. And what I mean by cascading updates is the following. Imagine an app that uses a lot of observable models. Now imagine one model fires an event. Let's say another model catches this event within the same VM turn and fires its own event. And like goals and goals, you have many models firing events. And along the way, views get updated or created. Such systems are very hard to reason about because your application state propagation and view state propagation, they're not separated. And so much depends on the runtime order of events, which you cannot see in your template, obviously. And also, such systems tend to be not very performant because you have to re-render the same thing multiple times. So how do we deal with it in Angular 2? Let's look at the situation. So let's say the model of this component fired an event, and we mark these passes to be checked. Let's say some other component, like this guy, its model triggers an event too, maybe as a result of the first event. And we mark these passes to be checked. Only now, only at this point, change detection will kick in and will go through the component graph. Only now the views are updated. Until this point, we were updating our application model, not view state. What's also very important here is that in order to have the guarantees I talked about a few minutes ago, where you can reason about your template statically, this guy has to be checked first and this guy second. And that's what happens when you use Angular 2. So I'm not saying that Angular 2 completely eliminates the issue of cascading updates. Your application state propagation can still be as crazy as you want it to be. But view state propagation, which Angular is responsible for, we hope is as predictable as possible. So I talked a lot about immutables and observables, but I want to clarify that we are not forcing a particular type of model on you. Angular remains open to different types of models. The only thing we are trying to do is the following. If you happen to have an immutable model because you like functional programming, for example, Angular can be much faster. If you happen to have an observable model because you like Rx, Angular again can be much faster. And the best part here is that you can combine different types of models in one application. For example, you can use immutable data for your facts and collection of facts, and observables for, I don't know, the data that comes from the backend. And they don't have to be layered like this. You can mix and match them. And Angular will take advantage of them performance-wise. All right, so what we've learned so far is that we decrease the average time of checking a binding, or the performance of change detection got 10x better. We also give you more control over change detection, so you can actually tell it what you want to be checked and when. And we use the same mechanism that we give to you to take advantage of immutables and observables. If you want to learn more, I recommend you checking out the following resources. I wrote a few blog posts about change detection, immutable objects, observable objects, and functional programming in Angular. Vyacheslav Figurov has an excellent blog about VMs where he talks about polymorphism and monomorphism. I think you need to check it out. It's awesome. And finally, Jafar from Netflix gave an excellent talk about using RxJS. You should check it out. Thank you.